mama been gone. I ain't had no loving. That's what I want, what I need. Little devil do me. Lord, sock it to me. Oh, baby, help me find my way. Sometimes, every once in a while, every now and then, in the midnight hour, my woman got me talking in the unknown tongue. She got me saying words, words I ain't never said before. What I mean is she got me confused, and I don't know what I'm saying. I can do something busy, and yeah, go go go.
Now you can turn yourself back. Good morning. My name is Susan Reardon, and I call the staff hearing officer meeting of December 14th to order. First on the agenda is requests for continuances, withdrawals, postponements, or additions to the agenda. And I haven't received any requests for changes, so we'll hear them in the order they show on the agenda. Under announcements and appeals, I want to announce globally, and then I'll announce after each item, that the appeal period is going to be extended to Monday, January 9th, given the two-week furlough that the city's closed. And so that way it'll give people, if they're interested in finding out more information on the project, time to be able to call and talk to staff. So the appeal period for all the items on today's agenda is going to end on Monday, January 9th. And that's the only announcements I have. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to address the staff hearing officer on items not on today's agenda? No? Seeing no one, we'll go to the first item, which is 849C Melinda Lane. Would you like to come up to the table?
Good morning. I'm Bill Wolf with Pacific Architects.
Good morning, Ms. Reardon. This project is, I'm Joanne LaConte, Assistant Planner, and this project is located at 849 C. Melinda Lane. The property is zoned A2, and current development on site consists of a single-family residence and an attached two-car garage. The proposed project involves permitting as-built construction of approximately 7.5-foot-high columns with gates and associated 5.5-foot approximately high pedestrian gate and wrought iron fencing. The requests before you today are for modifications to allow the gates, columns, and associated fencing to exceed 3.5 feet in height when located within 10 feet of the front lot line and within 10 feet of either side of a driveway for a distance of 20 feet back from the front lot line. A little background for this project, a zoning report was done in 2010, and that zoning report did not identify the overheight columns, gates, and fences. In May of this year, the property owners applied for a modification for an overheight fence at the front of the property, and that was approved subject to conditions. These items were not included as part of that approval because they were identified later in the process, and so the applicant is coming today to try to resolve these issues. Regarding these columns and gates, the vehicle columns and gates were actually constructed with the required building permit. However, that permit showed that the gates and columns were to be located 20 feet from the front property line. Because the property line is curved at the front, some of the portions of the gate were actually not only 12 to 19 feet, depending on where you measure it from the property line, and that's what the issue is today. Also, the building permit did not include the little wrought iron gate and associated fencing in this area. This project was heard at the Single Family Design Board in November of 2011 and was forwarded to the staff hearing officer with comments. The purpose of the fence and height limitations in this location is to provide adequate vision clearance and open streetscape for property. Transportation planning has reviewed this project and has determined that adequate vision clearance has been provided consistent with the zoning ordinance. However, transportation planning typically requires gates to be set back 20 feet so that vehicles do not key up on the street and interfering with vehicular and pedestrian traffic. So in the current location, transportation planning said that there could be some conflict with potential with vehicles and pedestrians on this street. However, this is a very low volume street. It starts out at a 50-foot easement in the roadway, and it narrows down to 20 feet in this location, and that the anticipated conflicts are minimized, and they wouldn't be the same as on city main streets or arterial roads. And therefore, transportation planning is recommending approval of it with the condition that any hedges on the property within 10 feet of either side of the driveway be reduced to 3.5 feet in height, consistent with the zoning ordinance. Staff has received three letters regarding the project, which were included in the staff report, and today we received another letter, which has been forwarded to you. And that pretty much concludes staff's presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions regarding the project.
Okay. Great, thank you. Good morning, you've already stated your name. Yes. Would you like to add stuff?
Yes, first of all, I want to thank Joanne and Steve Foley for their efforts in trying to help us find a resolve for the for this gate issue. We're definitely happy to work with Steve on his request with the condition that we trim back hedges to the required height on our property line, both right and left sides of the gate. of course, some of the planting is on the neighbor's property, and we, of course, don't have control of that, but we'll do the planting and the trimming on our side, certainly. I also wanted to point out there were a couple of examples that I had submitted as well on similar streets where one at C. Melinda, which is actually just two or three houses down, where the gate is very close to the street right of way, and they've had success there with that. It's a rolling gate, and I believe it's 5 or 6 feet back. Another one on Summit Road, which is a road very similar to this one in that it loops back and forth, and it's a very low volume traffic condition. And both of these were actually, this one in particular, of course, back in 82, I believe was when it was approved, it had to go through modification process, and it was allowed at that point in time. This one happened to be actually in outside of their property and was in the public right-of-way, so it went through Public Works and was reviewed there. So just a couple of examples again of conditions which are actually a little worse than our situation that have been approved in the past historically.
Well, generally in modifications we look at site-specific conditions, why it's necessary in this case, although that's interesting to note. We need to look at the site-specific type stuff.
Sure. And our thoughts as well is that even though it measures at 20 feet from the center, if we, and my thoughts are, if we are able to trim planting back along this side, the tendency would be to have the car probably pull into where the deepest part of it would be in anticipation of this gate waiting to open. Get out of the car and then open the gate and then move in. The other advantage is that the slope on the property, it drops quite a few feet, so that actually visibly when you're standing here, those pilasters appear to be about 4.5 feet tall from the street. So it drops substantial at that point. The other nice thing is that we have enough room in this driveway area here so that cars leaving the site will have the opportunity to actually back out of the garage and head forward out this gate instead of backing out onto a street. So in terms of safety, we felt that was a good point to make, that you could actually forward car out of the driveway. And again, the letters that you have as well that show support of the neighbors, it's been there for quite a few years and they haven't had any issue with it at this point. Anyway,
I think that covers my thoughts so far. Okay, great, thank you. I do have a question for staff, or I see Steve's here. In regards to the fence location. I know in past projects we've had discussions on the location. Is it better to have it closer to the street, farther away, and all that? And then also, if it is going to be closer to the street, and the potential for conflicts between the different uses of the street. I've seen transportation staff recommend conditions regarding electronic gates, and I noticed that this wasn't a recommendation in this case.
Thank you, Steve Foley, Transportation Planning and Public Works. Yes, as far as the discussions, as far as the location of the gate, typically when we look at allowing the gates, we're usually comfortable when they're at the property line, because then as far as you having an electrical gate, they can be opening or opened as they approach, and it doesn't allow somebody to, for instance, if it was a few feet back, to block a sidewalk or the travel way. In this case, it was so close to meeting the requirement. It's 20 feet to the center. Actually, as you approach, as it was mentioned, it is more natural to be to the, I guess it would be the east side of the driveway. So I've been out to the site, measured it with a car, and I don't think that it's quite possible. I wasn't able to tell exactly where the property line was, but the car was able to actually remove itself from the travel way, so I wasn't concerned that the gate was going to be a potential, even if it wasn't electrically actuated, to have to be on there waiting for the... So I think a car can get off the road in order to access the site.
Okay. Great. Thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item? Not seeing one, I'll close the public hearing. And I've received the letters that you alluded to. This one is included in the packet that was sent earlier. I again went out to the site and did another site visit, because at the earlier hearing when I approved the fence along the front property line, I had a lot of concerns regarding site visibility and exiting it. And actually looking at the site, I'm not quite sure that this fence was built to approval, that the fence height is measured from the lowest point of grade, which would be here. So when you measure up this way, I think it exceeds 42 inches. So that's going to have to be verified and looked at. It's from the lowest point. I know on here it talks about 42-inch maximum, but that might be from this side. It's actually from the lowest point of contact. So that is a requirement that be 42 inches in height. In regards to the columns and the wrought iron gate, I don't have a concern with that. It's wrought iron. You can see through it. The columns, I agree, they're set back far enough that they aren't going to impede visibility. In the previous situation, there was a fence with ivy with, sure, you know, who knows what height it actually was. So there was a lot going on the site. I do have concerns with the gate and the potential conflict with users of Sima Linda, and I totally respect Mr. Foley's opinions. And I noticed both times I've gone out there, the road does narrow down, and on the opposite side of the street, there's a curb, and pedestrians have to walk in the street. So I get concerned with the potential for, you know, conflict of the users of the street. So what I would like to see is, I actually would like it to be electronically actuated, so that you can pull in, and there's less waiting on the street. There's just less potential for the conflict. And that's the way I think that I could get to the point of supporting the project. And I don't know if you're willing, if you're open to that suggestion.
If I may take 30 seconds,
sure,
and consult.
Okay, sure.
I'll be right back. Thank you for that. Yes, yeah, we'll accept that condition with the automatic gates,
okay.
Which in a way will have a tendency to probably pull your car to the side that's longest as well, because we'll have probably some kind of a kiosk there, a keypad,
okay.
As a potential.
Okay. All right, so with that, those added conditions, one, that the vehicle gate be electronically actuated, and then also the verification of the 42 yeah. inches from grade. I can approve your project. One other actually question I have with staff, and you mentioned it in your presentation too. The existing condition that you're recommending regarding the hedges along the driveway, I noticed on the site plan it just mentions on the left side, and on the conditions of approval it says along the existing driveway. So what I'm assuming that to mean is that the hedge is on their property.
Correct.
Because yes, you can't go on the neighbor's property.
Neighbor's property, yes.
So I would just like to make that clear in the first condition, that the existing hedge along both sides of the driveway, and that it does mean your property.
On our property.
So just so it's clear.
Yeah.
So with the changes to condition number one and then the addition of the other two, I approve your project. And like I said at the beginning of the hearing, the appeal period has been extended to the 9th, yeah. And so the Planning Commission also has oversight authority of all my actions, and if they thought this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same appeal period.
Yeah. Okay.
And if that was to happen, Joanne will contact you.
Okay.
Right? Thanks.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I have them all stamped. You want the pictures? And I'll just keep this. The next item is Franceschi. 1540 Franceschi Road. Good morning.
Good morning. And good morning, Ms. Reardon. Dan Gullett, Associate Planner. This is 1540 Franceschi Road. This is a 17,438 square foot A2 lot. Due to the zoning setbacks and the shape of this lot and the topography, it's a highly constrained lot. There are 30-foot setbacks along Franceschi Road and the private road that accesses the residence above. So what's left outside of the setbacks is this small area that's highlighted here. So most of the existing house is outside of the area that where building is allowed currently. So it's a non-conforming building, and the proposal is to convert existing non-habitable storage space to provide elevator access between the garage and the two other levels of the house. So there is actually no change in the footprint. There's no additional openings on the outside of the building. And staff believes the proposal is appropriate and supports the proposal. No design review was required because there are no exterior changes. So staff's recommending that the project be approved as submitted.
Great, thank you. Would you like to state your name for the record and add additional comments?
Sure. Yeah, Brian Nelson, project architect. I think staff has done a great job of explaining it, as I think the important part is it's all interior. There's nothing on the exterior that neighbors or anybody going by would even know that there was a new elevator. The other important part is to add an elevator on a three-level house for a couple that, you know, are getting up in age is an appropriate change in the inside of the house. So, and we're not even having to change a foundation because the space that partially that we're using, the part that is requiring the modification, is, you know, only 50 square feet of storage space that's in a basement right now. So those are my only comments.
Okay, great, thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anybody here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item? No. I did receive one letter from Ms. Paula Westbury expressing concerns with the project. I don't know if you received it, Brian.
I did.
So I'll close the public hearing. This project, it's appropriate. There's, you know, like you said, it's all understory. There's not any exterior changes. It's not visibly, visibly noticeable off-site and even, you know, on the subject site. So I can make the findings, approve your project. There's no proposed conditions of approval, and I don't believe any are necessary.
Great.
So that's a quick, easy item.
Thank you.
Approve it. And like I said at the beginning of the hearing, you were here, that the appeal period has been extended to Monday, January 9th, given the furlough. And then also the Planning Commission has oversight over all my actions, and if they thought this warranted discussion before then, they could call it up during that same period.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
Great, thanks.
So the next item and the last item is 818 North Voluntaria.
So this project is located at the end of the dead end of North Voluntaria Street. This area used to actually be public right-of-way connecting, Voluntaria used to connect to Canon Perdido on paper. It was never actually improved like that. There's a large change in topography, but there has been a historic pedestrian trail in this area. So the city abandoned the road right-of-way, and Mr. Tice acquired a portion of the right-of-way, and the city retained a pedestrian trail easement through the right-of-way to retain that historic connection. It's not a connection that has a lot of circulation traffic with pedestrians, but it has been used by the community. There has been recent nuisance behavior on the pedestrian easement. The police department has been involved. Eventually, the neighbors, including the applicant, Mr. Tice, requested to build fencing across the easement and close it off to circulation because it became such a problem. And Public Works and the police department worked to seek alternatives to the trail closure and eventually decided a temporary closure of the trail was warranted. So there was a chain link fence built that blocked off the entrance on Voluntaria Street, and the applicant, Mr. Tice's property is adjacent to it. So the current regulation is that fences be 3.5 feet or less within 10 feet of the front lot line, which this is. So the issue was that the trails here, this was blocked off, and then he would only be allowed a short fence here, making this area of his property susceptible to trespass. So the applicant actually has an as-built fence that's 6 feet tall. It's 18 feet wide, and there's an additional pedestrian gate that's 2.5 feet wide at the end of the road. And this is the subject of an enforcement case, and this application would abate that. So the proposal is to retain that fence at that location. There are a couple other issues with the enforcement case. There was a deck constructed and a shed constructed, and they were in the interior setback, and there was also a parking area that's gravel just behind the fence, and the fence was built as a rolling fence. So staff is recommending condition that the fence be fixed because parking's not allowed in in the front setback or interior setback. So also staff's recommending a condition that this gravel area be re-landscaped subject to single family design board approval, and that a subsequent building permit be acquired for the fence with plans that show the fence accurately and elevations that show the fence accurately. So staff is reporting or supporting the retention of the fence to prevent unreasonable hardship to the applicant. ABR reviewed this fence on consent and stated that it had no aesthetic impact and did ask for a small change, and this project would return to ABR if approved. But staff is recommending approval of the project subject to those conditions. That concludes my statement.
Now, what about the storage shed? Didn't you say that was in the setback?
No, it's not.
So the deck and storage shed were in the setback before.
The storage shed never, well, it was on the side.
Can you state your name for the record?
Hi, Greg Tice, applicant. The deck extended to the property line. We cut it back 6 feet to modify that within. So at the current time, it is approximately 25 feet back and 6 feet back from that. So it's not in any setback position right now.
So at the time of application?
Yeah, the little side piece was there, and we took that off.
Okay.
The gate is now fixed, immovable.
Do you have a formal presentation you want to make, or just...
Well, frankly, I'm not quite sure what we're doing today, so I'll just follow your direction. But Dan, I'm only asking for a modification of the fence height. Why are we concerned about the gravel back there? Because that I put a barrier down with the gravel to keep the weeds down, and we're not going to park a car there. I got that message loud and clear. So,
what it is when you come forward for a discretionary application, mm-hmm. all zoning violations need to be fixed on your property. So okay. That's come up as part of this application is because whatever zoning violations are on your site, you need to clear them up.
Okay.
I do have a question. As Dan indicated, okay. fence height's limited to 3.5 feet within the front 10 feet of your property.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why couldn't the fence be conforming and put at the 10 feet?
Say that now.
The requirement is within 10 feet of the front property line, it needs to be 3.5 feet tall. So one of the first things we look for in modification applications is what is a conforming option. Well, in this instance, the conforming option would be at 10 feet from the property line. So I was just questioning, why couldn't the fence be pushed back to 10 feet?
Well, we've got a grade change. We're coming off the top of the Riviera here. It goes all the way down to Milpas before it flattens out. So the slope is going this way, and it's going this way. It's really a difficult site. And if you look at what we're dealing with on the side there, just so the record shows, that's what my neighbor did at this end with no approval whatsoever, because we got a modification and encroachment permit from the city.
Encroachment permits are for improvements proposed in the public right-of-way?
Correct.
So if this is on your private property, the encroachment permit wouldn't be for this portion of the fence.
No, I understand. I got stuck in a catch-22. You know, the kids are just going to jump over my little fence if it's not high enough and come down here.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. The other question I have, still looking at conforming options.
That would be a hardship for us.
Okay.
Because this is the flattest part of the land right there where the old road bed is. So that's easier to put the fence. If I move it back 10 feet, the fence is now going to start going like that.
And if I could add something to that. So to move it back, Mr. Tice would have to acquire an additional encroachment permit to go across the trail further back. So the trail comes back at an angle from the corner. So it would be an additional requirement of Mr. Tice.
Okay.
And staff is supporting it as it is. I just want to point out here, the path is a concept. You know, you take a linear piece of paper and you drop this down. And the truth of the matter is the kids came from a point here down to here. And the path took a life of its own, and it went like this, and it went all over. So When we abandoned this back in 2004, the concept was there would be a 15-foot wide area reserved for the path, and the path would be in somewhere inside of this. It wasn't really defined. So really, this is hillside, so the path never went there. You can see how steep that is right mm-hmm. there. In fact, the city constructed a cement retaining wall there because it drops straight down about 15 feet. So it's just very difficult terrain there, Susan, if you came out and stood there.
I did. I went out and visited the site. I looked behind and saw the gravel and that it was flat with the deck. So it appeared that there is room to move it back.
Now, is there any harm in having access for our gardeners to have access back there?
Well, there is a pedestrian gate in the staff recommended condition allows for the pedestrian gate.
Okay. And that's right here. This is actually at an angle. Just the way the terrain does, the gate is set at an angle like that there. So
yes,
this doesn't accurately reflect that.
I saw it on
because we had a lot of problems with this bottom of the lot when we built the houses 4 years ago, just getting everything to true up.
Okay. Well, that was my question, why you couldn't push it back.
Okay.
I have another question actually for Dan regarding the findings. Talk about this fence is necessary to block access. However, the entrance to the pedestrian trail is not on the property.
Right. I actually have changes I would recommend to the finding. So it does say that given the city's decision to close public access to the trail and the allowed construction on one half of the width of the trail easement, it's actually one half of the width of the right-of-way that should be...
Yeah.
The city allowed construction of the chain link fence on the adjacent trail easement. The construction of a 6-foot tall fence is appropriate to adequately restrict trespassing on the subject property. There is an error in the recommended finding.
What about the fact that it's just a temporary encroachment permit, that they're trying to find funding to make the trail more secure? So that.
Can I comment on that?
Yeah.
This came between the Transportation and Circulation Committee. They found absolutely no use for the trail and recommended total closure. So no one is actually seeking funds to open this up.
Okay. That's not what it says in the memo.
Okay. Dan, you were here for the hearing. And you heard what they said.
I did speak with transportation staff following the Transportation and Circulation Committee hearing. I actually didn't attend that hearing, but from what I understand, Transportation and Circulation Committee didn't see this easement as a priority per se, just because the volumes are so low. It doesn't provide a connection between two large populated areas, and there's alternative routes along the streets. But the way transportation has approached this is that it is a temporary closure pending funding and design of a trail at this location. But there's no timetable set for that. But the trail easement still exists, and it was just encroachment permits that were granted, and the city has the right to revoke those encroachment permits, given a certain amount of time and notice to the property owners. So it is considered temporary.
This subject modification, though, does not go over the trail easement.
It does not, correct.
Okay. So what was the finding? What was the change to the finding? I got part of it. Allowed the construction of a chain link fence on the adjacent trail easement. So just read from given that last sentence. Read from up here to me.
Okay. So given the city's decision to close public access to the trail and the allowed construction of a chain link fence on the adjacent trail easement, the construction of a 6-foot tall fence is appropriate to adequately restrict trespassing on the subject property.
Okay. All right. Well, like I said, I went out to the site and I've read the staff report, and I had a number of comments or questions regarding why it can't be pushed back, and I understand some of the reasons or the reason why it needs to be in this location. So I can make the finding outlined in the staff report. However, I would like to add a condition and modify the first condition. The first one talks about the redwood fence shall be fixed in place and shall not be altered to allow for vehicular access onto the property of this location. The pedestrian gate may remain subject to conditions of approval by the ABR. I'd also like to add that not only fixed, because that could be in a lot of ways, you know, just locked, that the sliding mechanism needs to be removed so that it is just a true fence.
It is removed, yeah.
Okay, even the sliding mechanism behind it, that not just the wheels on the bottom, but just so it's fixed.
Okay. So what we had is a latch there. The latch is now sealed with a lock. Mm-hmm. Is that fixed enough, or do we need to cable it onto the post?
It needs to be a fence. What I'm approving is a fence at that location. So, like, this is a fence. Mm-hmm. So this here, it looks like a gate. So it needs to be made as a fence. So, you know, I know there's poles behind there, and usually there's a mechanism that's, you know, you can slide back and forth. So that needs, it just needs to be a fence with no sliding mechanism.
Okay.
Then also I'm going to add, it's a requirement, but I'm just going to add it just so that it's clear that all existing zoning violations, which is identified in your existing case, that's ENF 2011-00563, shall be abated with this permit.
And they are abated as we sit here.
That's great. So you've already complied with the condition.
I did. Okay. We moved the car. As soon as Dan told us you guys weren't going to support it, the car came out. It hasn't been in there.
Okay. Yeah, and then landscaping, it needs to be re-landscaped.
So, Dan, what kind of landscaping are you talking about?
So, you know what? Let me finish the hearing, and then you can meet with him afterwards on that. All right? So, with the change to condition number one, and with the revised finding and the change to condition one, and the additional condition regarding abatement of the existing zoning violations, I approve your project.
Okay.
And as you heard, since I saw you here since the beginning of the hearing, the appeal period is extended due to our furlough to January 9th. And the Planning Commission also has oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same period, and Dan would contact you if that was to occur.
Okay.
So that is the last item on the agenda, so I adjourn the meeting.
Thank you.